Welcome back. In this lecture, we will expand on one of the five major characteristics of primates, their sociality, concentrating on the anthropoids, the monkeys and apes. Our starting fact of central importance is this. Within their social groups, individual monkeys and apes form strong social bonds with selected companions. What this means is that monkey and ape groups are not formed because of something like a herd instinct. These animals don't just stay together to have warm bodies around. They're not together just to have extra eyes to find predators, extra brains to detect food. There's more to it than that. They are together, at least in part, because they form individual connections, emotional ties, and even build up social histories over time with each other. And this sets them apart from at least some other mammals and many other mammals in the quality of their social relationships. Some of the strongest social bonds that primatologists have observed are between kin. In other words, many non-human primates recognize and act preferentially towards their relatives. Kinship is an axis of social behavior that's very important. As I have hinted to you earlier, because we've talked about populations being open, there is a rule in mammalian biology. Typically in mammals, including primates, one sex stays in the group into which it is born, their natal group. The other sex transfers out of that group and breeds in a second group or population. So it is sometimes the case that both sexes will leave their natal group, but more often it is the case that one stays and the other goes. What this means then is that one sex will tend to be surrounded by its relatives as it lives in its natal group, and the other sex will transfer and go elsewhere and not be surrounded by relatives. Now, other social bonds exist besides those that are mediated by kinship. These tend to be predicated on close associations, or what some primatologists might even want to call friendships. Now, we don't want to just import the term friendship from human societies and use it uncritically. Rather, primatologists who talk about friendships measure them and set apart that type of social relationship from others. They may measure, for example, proximity, staying close together, a lot of grooming. This grooming that I've mentioned several times is not just hygienic for picking out bugs from the fur, but it's very soothing and very bonding. Another indice of friendship might be, for example, helping somebody else in a tense situation, coming to someone's aid. Some of the best studied monkey species live socially in groups organized around groups of female relatives. These groups take the term matrilines. Now, a particular old world monkey species, the rhesus monkey, has taught anthropologists a great deal about living in matrilines, particularly at one site, the island of Cayo Santiago off Puerto Rico. Now, I hope you've already stopped yourself and said, wait, she said it's an old world monkey. What are they doing living on an island off Puerto Rico in the New World? Well, this is an interesting story in itself. Back in 1938, researchers went to India and imported slightly over 400 monkeys across the sea to this island, and ever since they have been studied. In fact, since 1956, they have been studied on a daily basis with detailed records. What this means is that we have more detailed long-term data on the Cayo Santiago rhesus than we have on Jane Goodall's chimpanzees, which relatively few people recognize. This is a treasure trove of information. Cayo Santiago is very vital and active as a scientific site today. It is 38 acres, and it's possible to get there on a relatively short boat ride across from the big island of Puerto Rico. There are no fewer than 900 monkeys on Cayo Santiago. Currently, these are organized into seven social groups, plus an extra eighth group that's made up of entirely males. I'm going to use Cayo Santiago as a case study for you, and it's appropriate that I should do so. I have a student from William & Mary who is interning there at the moment. My student Christy Hoffman is studying female-female mating and competition. She's an intern to the scientist in charge on the island. It's a great deal of work, long days, lots of observation. I've had two students who did similar work on Cayo Santiago before, but it is also a beautiful area. You're on an island surrounded by the beautiful sea, and of course, it is also extremely important and rewarding work. Now, one of the organizing principles of rhesus monkey life on Cayo Santiago is dominance. Dominance is the relative ranking of monkeys according to their access to resources, food, shelter, mates, something like that. We know a great deal about dominance from a certain time period at Cayo Santiago, a certain number of years that were studied in depth by the primatologist John Berard, who used to be the primatologist in charge on Cayo Santiago. Now, first, before I get into his data, I want to make a remark about dominance. Dominance is too often thought of as some kind of a lifetime achievement award. In other words, that a monkey becomes dominant at some point in his or her life and just is dominant. That's it. He or she is always dominant from then on. And in fact, it is much more of a fluid and changing situation than that. Dominance, for at least some animals, tends to be relatively short-term, a life cycle phenomenon. This is true of the males on Cayo Santiago. Males may rise in the dominance hierarchy and stay high up in the dominance hierarchy, but they stay there for relatively short periods. They are deposed by rivals relatively soon, say maybe a year and a half, 2 years, 2.5 years, something like that. For females, it's a little bit different, and the position in the hierarchy is a little more solidified and a little more stable. And we'll explore that in a minute. There are three basic facts that have emerged from Berard's and other scientists, too, data on dominance among the rhesus monkeys of Cayo. First, these various groups on the island are ranked in relation to each other. The rule seems to be that the bigger groups are dominant to the smaller ones. And there isn't a lot of fighting here. The bigger groups simply can push the little ones off a path or away from resources. If two groups are relatively similar in size, there may be more actual aggression and fighting to determine who gets rights to a certain area. Secondly, within a group, matrilines are ranked in relation to one another. And remember that a matriline is a group of related females. So a matriline would have grandmothers, mothers, aunts, sisters, all kinds of related females. So in this sense, defining a family as females, you get a kind of ladder or strata, if you will, of females in families that are ranked one against the other. And there's yet a third layer of dominance. Within a matriline, there's a particular rule that seems to obtain. Primatologists call this youngest sister ascendancy. And what this means is that each mother favors her newest daughter. And this may at first seem a little counterintuitive. You might think that the daughter who's older, who's been around longer, would be supported by her mother over a new one, but this is not the case. Now, an example may help here. Let's make up a hypothetical rhesus monkey living on Cayo named Zelda. She has 4 children in her life, 4 infants. Her first infant is a female. And let's make, for fun, Zelda be the alpha female of the alpha matriline, that is, the top-ranking female in the top-ranking matriline of this group. So she's in charge. And her daughter is born, and her daughter comes to rest right beneath her mother in the dominance hierarchy. Even as an infant, this little kid, this little infant, can boss around other adults that are lower ranking. This is not, of course, because she herself is powerful or strong, but because she's doing this with the backup of her mother, who will come to support her. Zelda, the mom, goes on to have infant number 2, also a female, and the second female then comes to rest above the first infant, below the mother. So the first infant goes lower in the dominance hierarchy. Now Zelda has a third infant, and it's a male. The male will enjoy being relatively high ranking while he's around, but he's not around all that many years because males on Cayo Santiago are the sex that transfer. So at a certain age, he leaves the group, and he goes and he mates and stays elsewhere. So he loses really the rank of his mother, and he has to start all over again in another group. Then infant four is born, and it's a female, and you already know what happens. And this continues on and on. Right around their first birthdays as yearlings, male and female rhesus monkeys begin to act differently and socialize differently. Female infants begin to really cement their ties within the match line. They spend a lot of time with their relatives, grooming, consolidating power. The males, on the other hand, start to hang around the periphery of their groups. They start to play with their male peers. This is play, but it's also testing strength. They're beginning to look at other groups that may come near them. They are beginning to scope out where they may transfer in the future. So the daughters, of course, are the ones who will have the important kin relationships in the future. So Cayo Santiago rhesus life is something we know a lot about. The key components have emerged quite clearly. Let's compare that case study with another. We'll look now at a great ape, and we'll return to the chimpanzee as a good example. Chimpanzees are great apes rather than monkeys, and they live social lives that are of interesting contrast to the social lives of Cayo Santiago rhesus. Now, we're going to rely on data from two different populations of chimpanzees: East African chimps, studied by Jane Goodall, living in Tanzania; West African chimps, studied by Christophe Bosch, living in Thai National Park in the Ivory Coast. Now, I want to give you one fact about chimps, first of all, and that is that unlike the rhesus monkeys we talked about, in this case, the males stay put in their communities and the females transfer. And what I'd like to ask you to do is a mental exercise. You may even want to put the tape on pause. Think for a minute what implications the fact that the males stay and the females transfer might have for sociality of chimpanzees. And I'll bet that you were able to predict this, because it turns out that chimpanzees are organized into patrilines, groups of related males. The patrilines form the core of the communities. And the females will go and mate elsewhere, and they turn out to be relatively not solitary, but they're not highly social in their new social groups. They will stay around other chimps, they'll stay with their dependent offspring, but they're not surrounded by kin, and they're not particularly friendly with other female chimpanzees. Now, dominance is important, too, in chimpanzee lives. The focus of attention within a community tends to be the male dominance hierarchy, and there does tend to be a single alpha male at the top, so that even a low-ranking male will tend to outrank a high-ranking female. The males are just the dominant ones in chimpanzees. What you find, though, is that the dominance hierarchy is neither linear nor simply based on physical strength. For example, two middle-ranking chimps may gang up together and be able to either overthrow or at least severely hassle the alpha male. It is also known from Goodall's work that being smart and having allies can put you on the path to being an alpha just as much as being big and strong can. A famous example is Mike, the chimpanzee that Goodall knew, who put together kerosene cans he found in the forest, banged them together, rolled them ahead of him down the path, and intimidated his rivals and rose straight to the rank of alpha, even though he was not particularly big or strong. Other alphas Goodall has known got to their position through support of their siblings or other male relatives. Now, male-male bonds are very much the focus of the community, very significant, whether they occur within the patriline or in some kind of friendship that I described for you before. And I'll give you a couple of ways in which these male-male bonds play out behaviorally for chimpanzees. First of all, male chimps work together to hunt. Male chimpanzees like to eat meat, and they don't just accept it when they stumble upon it. Rather, they go out and search for it and bring down prey. The favored prey of chimpanzees are colobus monkeys, old world monkeys that live in the trees. And the interesting part is that the males use their bonds to not hunt singly, but work together. So they go out in particular groups. At Tai in the Ivory Coast, there's a male named Brutus who was just an incredibly good hunter. He seemed more so than other chimpanzees to be able to anticipate actions of his fellow chimp hunters and actions of the monkey prey. And he had a very high success rate, but he always did this in concert with other male chimps. Then at the end of the hunt, if there's a kill, the meat is shared, usually between the hunters and sometimes distributed to females. So it's a process not just of hunting, but of food sharing afterwards. That is a male type of activity. Secondly, males cooperate to go on patrol. That is, males will actually walk along the borders of their territories together, and they will look for possible neighboring groups or strangers. They often will do this walking single file and silently. Now, when I say silently, I mean they don't vocalize, they don't scream. Sometimes when they're setting out, they will gather together at the base of a big tree and they'll drum on that tree. So they can make noise in that way. And scientists speculate that this may be a way to announce their strength in numbers by drumming. They can get a lot of animals making a lot of noise. Sometimes, by the way, if the patrollers find strangers near their borders, very aggressive and violent encounters may result. We know of this mostly from Jane Goodall's work. So this brings up an important point. The male-male bonds that we're talking about exist within the community. They do not go across community lines. So if males meet other males or other females, the relationship that results is a hostile one, and there may even be lethal violence in some cases. So, chimpanzee communities are very male-oriented. They are much more so than our rhesus monkey groups. Now, male rhesus certainly care a lot about dominance. They jockey for position, and they fight each other for this. But in the rhesus monkeys, remember, there's a locus of power in the matrilines because the females are surrounded by their relatives. And this is simply not the case with the chimpanzees. So the real socio-emotional focus, if you will, tends to be around the males in chimpanzees. Okay, another contrast that we can make is that ape youngsters develop much more slowly than do monkey youngsters. So if we compare the chimps to the rhesus, we see a different developmental trajectory. We know that at 1 year of age, the rhesus monkeys begin to diverge behaviorally by sex. This is not so much the case with chimps, because a one-year-old chimp is still a very young dependent infant. The one-year-old infant is being carried and held close to the mother, still suckling on the mother quite a bit. So there's a longer period. We know that the infancy period lasts at least 4 years in great apes. The entire lifespan lasts longer in great apes. It is not unusual for great apes to live into their 40s, and that would be quite unusual for a monkey. Now, at some point, of course, you do get behavioral divergence by sex in chimpanzees. When females reach their puberty, they start to get what's called a sexual swelling, an area on their rump of reddened, tightened skin that indicates to males that they're capable of being impregnated. In other words, it's a signal of fertility. When these swellings first occur, the females begin to move to the periphery of their natal communities, and soon after, they then transfer. We know that there are some exceptions. Not every single chimpanzee in the world transfers at puberty. There are some famous examples that Jane Goodall has told us about. The old female Flo and her daughter Fifi lived together in the same community. But this is by far a minority pattern. Almost all female chimpanzees do transfer and therefore end up in groups without kin. All right, so we have noted some differences in social organization between chimps and rhesus monkeys. These two species and their differences attest to the balance between cooperation and competition that characterizes group living in anthropoids. What I mean here is that group living is about access to resources in one way. There are usually limited resources available. There's not just, you know, totally abundant food or shelter. So that there has to be some kind of competition that results for these resources. And dominance hierarchy seem to be one way of organizing that competition. But yet, competition is only one half of the story. As we have seen, there's also a lot of cooperation. Cooperation evolves, develops between individuals and can be based on the social ties that I have talked about. So we don't see individual monkeys and apes coming together just to solve some kind of task. We don't see them coming together, finding a bunch of ripe fruit, eating, and then going apart. We don't see them coming together just to hunt and then finishing the task and then going apart. We see that after the particular task is accomplished, they stay together in different ways depending on the species, but the sociality is continuous. So that you have what we might consider to be a real emotional matrix for the behavior that unfolds. So when animals finish feeding or finish hunting, let's take chimps as an example, and they're dividing up the kill, there can be a lot of excitement, embracing and kissing and vocalizing. Let's say that there was a squabble that broke out over some prized meat, if it's in rare supply, between two chimpanzees, and there was fighting. At the end of the fight, more often than not, there's a process of what we call reconciliation, where the two animals both seem very interested in, quote-unquote, making up, if you will. They will seek each other out, they will hug, they will groom each other, and essentially repair the break in the social bond. Many things like this happen so that we understand that there's an emotional underlay here to the social bonds. I believe that that socio-emotional nature of the social ties is more pronounced in apes than it is in monkeys, and we'll return to that question a little bit later. But it is true that it is still essentially there, just elaborated differently in different primates. So just as Sherwood Washburn envisioned when he talked about the new physical anthropology, what we see is comparative research that really yields useful conclusions about primate evolution. What I have done so far in this lecture is to tell you essentially two case studies. I've picked out two primate species that are extremely well known and well studied, the rhesus monkey of Asia, or Cayo Santiago, and the chimpanzee of Africa probably have more scientist hours logged on them than any other. In other words, many, many more hours put into studying these types of primates than some others. But yet, what I want to do is to be able to talk about some things more generally. And again, step back a little bit and talk about patterns. We can conclude by saying, first, a deep layer of primate social grouping and social bonding is present, despite variation in form. This goes right back to our initial statement that sociality is almost ever present in primates. Now, just as we have said that we're tropical in origin as humans, just as anatomically we have all of the characteristics of being primate, it's important for me to get across to you that the sociality is an adaptation that is ancient in primates. The variation that we do see across species in social grouping and social bonding can be understood as well. This is a whole subarea of study within primatology. Why is it that in rhesus monkeys, the males transfer and the females stay, but it is the reverse in chimps? That is an interesting question. We can begin to understand the variation in primate social organization by looking at a combination of factors. We would know from our knowledge of evolutionary theory that we want to be thinking about natural selection and adaptation to local conditions. Food is a big part of that. A big part of what we mean when we say local conditions are nutrition and food resources. These factors are combined, of course, with the individual species biology. Their brains, what kind of learning do their brains permit? What does their anatomy allow in terms of feeding and foraging? Having talked so much about variation between rhesus and chimpanzees in how they're organized, I do want to say just a little bit about the prevailing hypothesis for why there is so much variation. And it has to do with food. And I'm going to say this relatively briefly. It will give you just a hint of how we can explain this variation. Females are absolutely dependent in any mammal on getting enough calories and nutrition to underwrite reproduction. Now, we know that reproductive success is key for any mammal. That is a given for understanding evolution. But if you think about it, females are really under a special burden when it comes to reproduction if you're a mammal. Because if you're a female, you are carrying a fetus, you're going to give birth to a live offspring, and then there's a period of protracted suckling or nursing, where the mother has to get enough caloric energy to be able to feed the baby as well. So the basic rule seems to be that if females can afford to stay together with their kin, by that I mean if they can get enough food by staying together as kin, they should prefer to do so. Certainly there are advantages to having your relatives around. You do have a built-in supply of allies, of grooming, of help in a variety of situations. However, there will be situations, and chimpanzees seem to be one of them, where the type of food that is the species-typical diet does not occur in plentiful enough numbers or wide enough distribution to allow females to stay together. In other words, we think, primatologists think, that if female chimpanzees did live together, they would be unable to support calorically their reproduction. The last thing that female mammals want to do is compete with their kin. Don't want to take resources from their kin. So what happens is, females transfer, they go and breed in another community, they do end up competing, but they're competing with their non-kin. And we know that they don't form terribly close friendships in these other communities. Now, admittedly, this is somewhat of a simplified explanation of a very complicated series of hypotheses that have been abundant in the primate literature, but it gives you a hint that we must understand not only how the species biology differs, but how environments differ, and quite specifically, how food supplies differ. A very typical exercise for a primatologist going into the field, this was true of me in Kenya, is to spend a great amount of time not just taking data on the behavior that is visible, but on the distribution and amount of food available seasonally, because that will determine a great deal of the behavior. Now, let's close the lecture by bringing the question back to the human species. And we can make a strong prediction based just on what we've learned in this lecture. Human evolution, too, should proceed according to adaptation to local conditions and selection pressures. So we can say that there's a very ancient base for sociality and for the emotional nature of sociality that was in place before the time period of human evolution. I think this is an interesting point to reflect upon. So often in courses and in textbooks, we tend to reduce human ancestors, hominids, to creatures that made a series of accomplishments, that reached a series of milestones, timelines, first bipedalism, first stone tools. When was the first art? So we tend to think of hominids as achieving a certain number of things over time. We rarely, I believe, think of hominids as living socio-emotional creatures that have sociality, that care about living in their social groups. Yet everything we know about monkeys and apes indicates to us that this would have been so also of hominids. With this background on sociality in mind, we want to turn to a slightly different aspect of primate behavior in the next lecture. We will be talking about cognition and learning, and we will focus in that lecture specifically on the great apes.